Analyzing two data sets together. This used to be amazingly difficult and problematic in the old world, but it's really easy in Power BI. So easy, it feels like magic. Keep watching. By the way, I would like to point out that something magical just happened. And we all missed it. Frankly, I missed it. But this is so cool. Sales and budget together in the same pivot table, essentially. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go back to my Excel and kind of try to show it to you here. So think about the old world. Let's refresh it. There we go. Now I see my budget. In the old world, I would have my sales, and let's say I would have it by the product category and subcategory. Let's do the same ones. Great. And let's change the layout. And then I would have my budget. Let's bring in budget here. And I'm going to bring in a slicer for year. And I'll connect this slicer to both pivot tables. Perfect, done. And I'm going to say only show me 2016. All right, so now it's apples to apples. But really, this is how it used to be done. If you had two separate tables, go back to the relationship. You had a sales data coming in and budget data coming in. You would flatten sales out. You would do VLOOKUP the heck out of it, get all the product attributes and get everything else, whatever you needed. And then you had budget data in another table, and then you would VLOOKUP whatever you needed to VLOOKUP. And then you ended up with two different flattened tables. Great. And then you would do two different pivots. But now we can have things in the same pivot. So let's see why that's such a big deal. Let's go back to our model. Let's go here, because not only can we have sales and budget side by side, and we can slice and dice them side by side. So let's go to month, and I'm gonna add month as a slicer. So I'm gonna go here, change it to slicer. And while we're talking about month, notice that it's messed up. It's alphabetical. Let's quickly fix that. We're going to go to the data tab, the calendar table. And all we have to change is change the sort by column. So if you notice here, this one says sort by. And you can override the sorting, which is by default alphabetical. But I can say, hey, the month actually needs to be sorted by the month number. So January is 1, December is 12, and so on. And now if I go back, working on it. Okay, there we go. Now it's sorted correctly. By the way, for those of you who have fiscal calendars, Microsoft, obviously I worked for them for a long time, so their calendar runs from July through June. So July is really the first month. You can easily set that up. We'll probably cover that in a later module, but that's really easy to do. Custom calendars, which are do not really follow month boundaries. They're four-week, 5-week, or something like that. Those can be handled as well. So we'll cover that in separate modules. But for now, we have the month slicer. So here, not only do you have sales and budget in the same pivot, and you can kind of slice and dice them easily. Perfect, great. But we can also define subsequent measures, which reusing the measures we just defined. So we have sales and budget, but now I can define, let's go to the budget table. Great, we're there. We can define kind of variance, and that can be sales. Let's zoom in a bit. Sales minus budget. All right, great. So before we go any further, I wanted to point out the way we use the syntax is if you have a column, it's always preceded by table name. And if you have a measure, as we had in this case, it does not have a table name. Now, sometimes you can get away by breaking these rules, but I really want you to follow this. So measures, stand by themselves, sales minus budget, but column names always have the table name as a prefix. So great, so this is the variance. And if we go back here, we can add the variance here. Let's see what it looks like. Let's get rid of the decimal places and notice how this is grayed out. I just switch to something else, come back to it, and now I can change it. I don't know why it does that. All right, great. So variance, we have that. You can also apply fancy coloring in it on it or things like that. We'll cover that later when we talk about visualizations. But really what we're seeing here is reuse of measures. So variance, I just reused my existing measures, and this is going to be huge. All right, get in the habit of it. If you have something defined, don't redefine it. So here, if I wanted, I could say, yeah, sum of sales amount, right, and minus, oops, let's close the brackets, minus sum of budget amount. I could have done that, but why? Right, and be lazy, because lazy is efficient. So here, I'm just going to cancel it. Here, we just reuse the measure sales minus budget. This is what I was talking about earlier, where you build things like Lego blocks. Simple queries in the query editor, you combine them to make complex queries. Or no, I'm not going to say complex, awesome queries, because they help your purpose, right? They get you closer to where you need to go. So here, if you want to define variance, we're just going to reuse the underlying measures, use them as Lego blocks. Great, so we have that, and now we're going to define one more, variance percentage. Variance percentage. So we're here, and this one we can define as variance divided by budget. We could do this, but division always has a danger of dividing by zero. So instead of this, I almost always use the divide function. If you notice here, the autocomplete tells you that, yeah, that's what exactly what it does. It's a safe divide with ability to handle divide by zero case. So great, so you have that, and instead of this, you don't need this anymore. This is a function call. You say numerator comma denominator, and you don't, the last parameter, by the way, is optional, so you don't need that. You can just close it. What this means is that if its budget ends up being zero, instead of giving you an error or something like that, it's just going to return a blank. That's the default for the third parameter here. So I almost never specify it. So divide this by this, perfect. And I have that. And again, I'm going to switch back to it again, change that to a percentage. See how it looks over here. Great. Maybe I'm going to make it just one decimal place. Perfect. Hey, keep watching more videos and keep learning Power BI. But if you did enjoy this video, I would love to hear from you. So leave a comment, like, subscribe, all the good stuff. Power on, my friends.